I have like full screen, so I'll just ask my colleague that is it visible now, my presentation. Okay, so I understand that now you are seeing the full screen. So hi, welcome everyone. I am Syed Naqvi, and today I will be talking about gravity and the waves of space-time. So first I will tell you a bit about what we as PhD students are doing at the Astronomical Observatory. Then we will go and understand the gravity of Newton, and then how Einstein came up with his ideas, and then how he changed the idea of space and time as two different entities into space-time as one entity. So as you can see, I have written wave of space-time together. So it's not a typo or something. Space-time becomes together when you go from Newtonian to Einstein gravity. And so about this talk, I will just first tell you about our observatory, who we are, where we work, and what we do. So we are a bunch of international PhD students. We work on different areas from astronomy, astrophysics, and cosmology. And currently, if you want to understand the status of a PhD student, nothing will explain better than the meme right now, I mean, which is in front of your eyes. And currently I'm not I am, and let's say all the PhD students are in the third zone. So we are in a PhD during a global pandemic. And let's say my face is somewhat similar to that scared cat. Okay. And this is our astronomical observatory in Krakow in Poland. So this is the observatory where we work. We observe the stars and the galaxies. We try to do observations, and in the winters when there is a lot of snow, we build like huge snowmen and play with them. Sometimes when we are tired, we lie down and sleep. So that is me sleeping after struggling with differential equations. Okay, and I would like to take a tour of our observatory if we can. Yeah, we can do this. So this is the link to our observatory. Some of it is in Polish, but don't worry, you can switch to English. And this is sort of a virtual tour of our observatory. So let me see. If you can see this hand arrow, not this mouse cursor thingy. So you can see that where I'm pointing this hand, there is, I mean, it's from that position where I am right now live in this talk. And then these are the telescopes. So this is our astronomical observatory in Krakow. So this is the beautiful city of Krakow. You take a bus, you climb a little hill, and these are our five telescopes with which we observe the stars and everything. And I can maybe go into one of them, and we can see the inside of what a telescope is and how you do the observations. So generally, you have this telescope in a dome. It's actually pretty cool in live, but now due to COVID, we don't have live guests. So here you open the shutter and you use the, let's say, the telescope to watch, let's say, stars. You watch planets. You watch, obviously, the moon. Moon is easy to watch, and moon is the name of my brother. And then, so this is our observatory, and here is how we do observations and all. And now I will return back to the main talk. So as I said that we are international PhD students, and we work on different topics. And what I do, so this small picture, I am over there. So what I study is that generally how an apple falls from the tree, and how similarly all the celestial objects are held together. They are held together by the same force known as gravity. And it is about this gravity what I work. So I work on the theoretical part of gravity, and slowly I'll tell you what I work on. Okay, so in this talk, what you are going to learn is first how things fall. So on the top left, top right, you see this big hairstyle guy called Newton, and there is another, this is Einstein who's laughing. So first we'll try to understand the concept of gravity from these two like very intelligent gentlemen. Then I will go and talk about gravity, like how when you throw an object, it falls, right? And similarly, something similar, but when you see the astronauts flying around the Earth, you see them as weight, as not massless, but weightless. So how does it happen? And then the idea, it would be a bit technical, but I would try to not make you sleep, is understand that how space-time is actually a rubber sheet and how this space-time is bent and how things are. So till now, the most successful theory of gravity we have is called general theory of relativity, which is on which I work. And then there are other emerging theories which are called, let's say, quantum gravity or string theory. But the till now most successful theory in terms of matching theory with observations is general or theory of relativity. And then in the end, I will end with something which are called the ripples in space-time. So till now, just imagine that you are throwing a water in a pond and you can see those ripples. And keep that image in mind because that is analogous to that we will have the ripples in the space-time. Okay, so let's move toward gravity. And whenever I will explain a topic, I will first explain like what a theory is, what an experiment is. So theory is there is some guy who's writing some equations on the board, and me and you and everybody can make a theory. But until and unless it is observed via experiments, it does not become successful. So brace yourself, knowledge is coming. Okay, so very long time ago, like let's say I don't know in how many hundreds of BCs, what used to happen is that people, obviously people were not, there were no Einsteins or Isaac Newton roaming around there. And at that time, people used to just draw and just analyze what they see. So at that time, obviously there was no pollution, so you could see the sky more clearly. So they used to draw paintings. So let's say this, I mean not let's say, this is a very old painting of how humanity perceived the universe at that time. So it was a story of something which is called doubt to belief. And what doubt to belief, I'll tell you. So this is this guy and okay, you draw trees, you have these houses, obviously you see this, you see the sun shining, you have the other stars. And then humanity or mankind used to imagine like, okay, what is beyond the stars? What lies ahead? And then as the society progressed, so did science. And earlier what used to happen is this is what we used to believe in. It was called the geocentric model. As most of you might have known that earlier it was assumed that Earth is the center of the solar system. So you can see that here you have Earth, here you have all the other planets. So yeah, you have see Mercurio is Mercury, Venus, Sol, and so at this point the idea was that Earth is the center, you have all the other planets and sun revolving around it, and much further you have God sitting chilling there saying, hey bro, what's up and all. But then along came Nicholas Copernicus, and he was the first one to get he first doubted this idea that whether it is actually geocentric model or not. He did some observations and he came to the conclusion that no, sun is the center of that, it's not universe, but sun is the center of the solar system. And his predictions matched the theory, and his model was what you can see right now. So here you see that you have the sun in the center, you have the planets here, so Earth, and I think you can have the Venus and all the other planets, you have the constellations, and then as usual, you have God chilling over there. So this was the heliocentric model. So the journey of doubt to belief for that, you had earlier Earth as the center of the solar system, but then you came to a conclusion that no, sun was the center. And why did you agree to it? Because obviously you had experimental proofs for it. And what we know now is very well experimentally verified that you have sun with the center and all the other planets are revolving around the sun in an elliptical orbit. And this is what we know. And the very important idea was by this guy with this hairstyle is Isaac Newton. So Isaac Newton's idea was that every particle attracts every other particle in the universe with a force. So if you can see, you can imagine this like Newton sitting under a tree or something, and he's trying to imagine. So this is a cartoonish image, but it is very important. So see, on the left you can see the apple is falling. He thought that okay, there is some force which is causing the apple to fall. And then his thought was that the moon is revolving around the Earth. So maybe the force with which moon is held towards the Earth is same at which the apple forms the tree to the ground. And this is how he equated this idea and came up with Newton's gravity. And again, This was the theory. And how do we know it's true? It's true because you have measured the rotation of all the planets. You know that in Earth you have 365 days. If you go to another planet, you have another number of days. So you come to the conclusion because you, I mean, you believe in Newton's gravity, his equations of motion, and so on. So yeah, and this is what I was saying, that in Newtonian gravity, it exactly tells us about the motion of the planets, the comets, and the stars. So you have the sun, you have the Earth and all the other planets. So you do your calculations following Newton's gravity and you can actually calculate pretty amazing things. So if on the left you see that this was a comet which is still available, not available, still visible to you, for you to see in the sky. So this is the comet Neowise. So you can actually do your calculations via Newtonian gravity and you can predict that when this comet would come. So this comet has come, I don't know how many thousands of years later, but right now if you look at a certain position in the sky, you can actually see that comet, and that comet is following Newton's gravity. Okay, and this is the basic formula which we go. I won't go into the formula because I have other equations and I don't want you to get a C now. Okay, before that, I would, because we have to make this a bit interactive, so I will all ask you a question and you have to write your comments, you have to write your answer in the comment section. So the question is very simple. So you have a feather, I mean a lightweight feather, and you have a bowling ball, obviously, which is heavy, and they are falling from some same height. So let's say some tower, same height, I take the feather, I take the bowling ball, and I let them fall. And let's say downstairs there is me or you standing and we are dabbing. So the question is, which one will fall first? So I will wait for a few seconds and then we will actually see a YouTube video that which falls first. So you have a feather and a bowling ball, they are falling from same height, which one will fall first? And I'll wait for a few seconds. And just type your answers in comment section. That's cool. If you are thinking in the direction of whether there will be air resistance or not, then that's a good way to think about it. I mean, the hint or the answer I can give is, if you are throwing, I mean, if two objects are falling under gravity, okay, so I have got few answers as the ball and, okay, both at the same time. Agnihotri says that, Laura Catherine Kerr said ball, Tanya Bhabi and Zubair Bhaiya said ball, okay. Good. And okay, now let's look into the video and now let's check out the video. Now in this video, it's a very long, but I will show you a very small portion and we will actually see what is happening. So this is the video. So I'll just tell you that, so what they are doing is that they have this feather and the ball and they are making it fall, but this time with air resistance. And Okay, so I guess the people who said ball are winning right now, and it is perfectly fine that they fall with this. But this is happening when there is air resistance. But what happens if it is falling in a vacuum? So these guys in this lab, like Brian Cox, he visited this lab and they had created vacuum. So by vacuum, I mean there is no air molecule, nothing. So when the feather and the ball are falling, they have nothing to resist the force. Now you might intuitively think that, okay, that won't make a difference, but actually something very surprising happens over there. So these guys have created a vacuum in that whole big tower and now they repeat the experiment. Okay, so here, just watch this carefully, it's really nice. And this is not slow motion. So when there is no vacuum, nothing, then the composition of the matter which is falling, it doesn't matter. They both fall at the exact time. And this is actually bizarre. Not bizarre, but it tells you about a very, very, let's say, I mean, what I would like to call, it's a very beautiful property of gravity, that gravity affects all the objects in the same manner. So till now, we had Newton's gravity, okay, everything attracts each other with some force. But when you remove this air resistance and all, the what is happening is that things are falling irrespective of their composition. Now, this was something, a bit of conflict which was happening, and then you needed another idea to explain this much more, let's say, accurately. And here is we meet this gentleman called Einstein. So most of the times whenever I'll just go back, that you had Newton's gravity, yes, and now you see that though both are falling at the same time irrespective of the composition when there is vacuum. And now the idea is like, what is actually happening? Can you explain gravity by a different kind of thing? And I studied general relativity in my master. I am studying it still in my PhD, and most of the times my expression is like this guy on the right. So gravity according to Newton is very simple, but gravity according to Einstein is a bit more tricky. So the basic idea which you have to keep in mind is gravity is bending of the rubber sheet or the space-time. Now what happens is in Newton's gravity, space and time are different entity. They both are not interlinked. But when Einstein came up with one theory which I have not said right now, this is called special theory of relativity. So Einstein came up with first special theory of relativity, where he brought the notion of space and time on an equal footing. And now when he wanted to incorporate the idea that how mass of an object will change the space-time, he came up with the general theory of relativity. And let's say, I think it would be this. Okay, so let's try to visualize how gravity looks like. Okay, yeah. So I was explaining to you what a rubber sheet is. So here is a professor explaining to his students what happens. Okay, so what happens is that your space-time is imagined as this rubber sheet, and there is this huge mass. So this mass you can imagine as sun. So when sun bends the space-time, and then all the other planets somehow follow the orbits like this. Obviously here he has thrown many planets, but this is something which is happening. Can he throw it again? Let's see if you have two objects. So this is somehow, and if you have like let's say two suns and how things are falling, it could be done in this way. So here you can imagine like there are two suns and how particles are moving. They are something which is, they are following what is called freely falling paths, and freely falling paths are actually defined in Einstein's general theory of relativity. So this feature is not in Newton's gravity. And what happens, okay, okay, also. So I'll just tell you once again that, so now the notion, so earlier you had Newton's gravity, now you had the Einstein's idea of gravity. What it actually says that space-time is on equal footing, things are moving around it. Now, obviously you can come up with a theory, but what are the experiments and all? Now, it happens that in Newton's gravity, if you switch off the sun like this, it means that if I take out or if I extinguish the sun like this, then according to Newton's gravity, you on Earth will notice this immediately. But what actually happens is that if you do proper calculations via Einstein's theory of gravity, you will come to the notion that it will take 8 minutes from Sun to Earth, the information coming that, you know, Sun has gone. Why this happens is because actually gravity is nothing but freely falling things in the geometry of space-time. And let's say you want to figure out what are the Einstein's equations. They are actually really complicated, but I assume that you are very rich. You can get a plane tickets, check. You can get on the plane and take off, and you have to find the train in somewhere near Bolivia. You go ahead, you walk, and you take a left turn, and you come up with the Einstein's equations. So these are Einstein's equations of gravity, and this whole theory is known as general theory of relativity, which I study. These are like cute letters, but they are like sort of 10 differential equations, which are really complicated because it took Einstein 15 years to come up with this theory. And what it actually means is that if you see an equation, you have something on the left hand side and something on the right hand side. And this meme actually explains what it is. So on the left hand side, you have space time, which tells matter how to move. And on the right hand side, you have matter, which tells space time how to curve. And this is how the interplay of gravity actually works. Now let's take a pause. Einstein came up with the theory, good. But what are the actual proofs? Proofs. I mean, how can I believe that, you know, Einstein is correct? Somebody else could have made this theory. Einstein did the maths and everything, and then here are the proofs. So this is the magic of general relativity, where you see the applications of Einstein's theory of gravity. So first was actually the bending of light. So what Einstein imagined, that if you have the sun is very massive, so it will bend space-time like this. So an actual star which is behind the sun, the path of the light is actually bent like this, and it reaches the Earth. And what we see on Earth is an observed star. So this is the apparent position. Okay, so Einstein calculated it, how much light deflection will happen. And thankfully, there was a solar eclipse on 1919, and Einstein's theory was confirmed. So you can do the same calculations with Newton's gravity. You will get an answer. Yes, you will. But if you do the calculations with Einstein's theory of gravity, you will get the exact bending of light which is happening. So this is one of the first proof that Einstein was right. Then second implication of the Einstein theory of gravity, because I showed you like one equations, but when you solve them, you come to know about something which is very weird, something which happens. Which is called gravitational time dilation. So as you can get from the word like time dilation, so time gets slow. So what happens is that when Einstein came up with this theory, there were these two guys, Pound and Repka. So if you can see this building, so at the bottom, Mr. Repka was there, and at the top, Mr. Pound was there. And what they were doing is they were throwing light up and down this building, and they were trying to measure time. So what happens is that when Mr. Repka is at the bottom, so he is near to the Earth, and Mr. Pound is at the top, so he is at a height. He's let's say a bit far from the Earth. So when you do the calculations, you come up with this concept called gravitational time dilation. So this means that the clock ticks differently at different heights on the Earth. So if you are on the ground floor and you live your life over there, let's say 100 years, and if there is somebody living on the 15th floor, time for that person will flow differently. In principle, it happens, but it would be let's say few seconds, so it won't matter. Similar thing happens if you look at the right hand side of the image. So you have the space time. The Earth is bending the space time due to mass. And what happens is that your satellites and all which work, via which you use your mobile phones and all, they send a light signal. So when the light signal is going from Earth to the satellite, it actually slows down. And when it comes back, it speeds up. So this is the process of gravitational time dilation which happens. So generally, whenever you are making a call or whenever you are using your GPS, some signals are sent to your satellite, they come back, and then you know the correct position. But if you do not include Einstein's theory of general relativity and also special relativity, you will be off by 10 kilometers. So this GPS, which is the global positioning system, it actually uses Einstein's theory of general relativity. And a bit of Interstellar, if somebody has seen this movie, it's a movie by Christopher Nolan. The science was based on a very famous physicist called Kip Thorne. And this happens that there were these two characters, Matthew McConaughey and Anna Hathaway, I guess. So they went to this planet. And this planet was nearby to something which is called a black hole. I'll tell it later, but for the moment, assume that it is like, it's immensely massive. Immensely massive object means immense gravitational effects, means immense gravitational time dilation. So Matthew McConaughey and the other character, they went down, and when they came up, so they spent 1 hour on this distance planet, but due to the gravitational time dilation, it was equivalent to 7 years on Earth. So when they come back and meet their other colleague, the other colleague has actually aged. And this was not some hoax hoax, this was actually proper calculation. So if you are near a black hole, these things will happen. Okay, now let's get into the idea of gravitational waves and how are they produced. So at the beginning of the lecture, I had told you to keep this image of ripples on the water surface. You have like very calm water, you throw a rock and ripples would be formed. So you can similarly imagine that space-time is like this, let's say, surface of water, not exactly because this is in three dimension, but when the ripples are having, there could be these ripples of space-time. So, but the idea is that if me and you, if we start to dance and move here and there, we will also produce gravitational waves, but they will be very small. So we need some objects which are immensely massive in order to produce such gravitational waves. And the two of them are black holes and neutron stars. And now the idea would be to study like how these black holes are producing these gravitational waves. Okay, I will pause again, but up till now what you have heard is, if you look at the top left corner, so initially what you have empty space, so there is no bending of space-time, no space-time curvature being bent. And then on the right, if you see this, so whenever you place a massive object on space-time, it bends the space-time. This is what is happening. But the basic question would be like, okay, if I have two heavy objects which are rotating around each other or revolving around each other, what will happen? What will happen would be the production of gravitational waves, and that would be like when space-time begins to shake a leg. So let's get an idea of how massive object should be in order to produce detectable gravitational waves. So this is one figure which you have to keep in mind. There's something called one solar mass is equal to 10 to the power 30 kg, which is a huge. So this is like the mass of the sun. And if you compare size wise, and if you think you are the amazing one, then this is the size of the Earth. So that is the position. That is our position in the universe. So we should not be too egoistic and all that. But what actually happens is that when these massive objects, they are revolving around each other, what happens to space-time? So look at the bottom right image carefully. So you can see this is the space-time sheet. The sun bends it a little. White dwarf also bends it. Neutron star bends it more, and black hole creates something which is singularity, but I won't go into it. But the basic idea is more massive means more deformed space-time. And when such objects move around, you have these ripples of space-time, which is actually the gravitational waves. So just a quick look into what neutron stars and black holes are. So on the top left, you see that. So neutron stars are leftover of a supernova. So generally, the sun, so our sun is a star. So in the life cycle of a star, it can actually end as a neutron star like this. Neutron star means it is only made of neutrons and it is like rapidly rotating with some particles pulsating like this, and its mass is twice of a sun. I have kept a question mark over there because people are still trying to constrain the neutron stars. And obviously you have seen neutron stars via your telescopes and everything. Then if a star is very massive and if it loses its fuel and everything, at one point it will happen that the gravity would be so much that even light cannot escape. So on the top right, you have an artistic image, but if you see on the top bottom, you have the first actual image of a black hole. So you can see that there is no light at the center, but there is some light surrounding. This is actually that there are some particles which are around the black hole. And since they are going into the black hole so fast, so they emit radiation. So this is sort of an indirect image, but this is a supermassive black hole. So the mass of this supermassive black hole is 7 billion times the sun. So it's huge. It looks like a donut or a vada, but that is what you have. And if your question is like, let's say if I have Earth and if I want to convert Earth to a black hole, what should I do? So here is the answer, that the Earth would become a black hole if compressed to the size of a marble. And I will explain it to you via a very simple formula. You know that density is mass by volume, right? If in a very small volume, you keep a huge amount of mass, the density overshoots. So this is something which is happening. So in black holes and neutron stars, huge mass is concentrated in a very small volume. Density is very high. Gravity is very high. And they are amazing objects, and they tell us about strong gravitational effects. And now once you have these objects in the universe, and let's say if two of them are revolving around each other, what will happen is like this. So you have these two black holes. These are creating the ripples of space-time, and this is what actually has been detected. So Einstein came up with general relativity, which I have abbreviated as GR, and gravitational waves in 1915. And in 2015, almost 100 years after Einstein came up with the theory, finally we were able to discover gravitational waves. So gravitational waves provide a direct evidence of like black hole kind of things. They exist. Again, keep in mind the same thing. You can create objects like black hole in theory and everything, but until and unless you don't have experiments to meet it, it's still a theory. So let's try to see one of it.
It's like, instead of the source of gravitational waves
So
without
here,
impact.
there's a very famous physicist, Brian Greene. He explains you how two massive objects, when they are revolving around each other, how space-time ripples are produced.
Hand jostling space. Instead, it would be some highly energetic astrophysical process like rapidly orbiting neutron stars or black holes that would send out a steady rumble of gravitational waves. Or at least, this is what the theory says should happen. Now, how do you test this idea? Well, the math shows that as a gravitational wave rolls by, it will squeeze and stretch anything in its path. You see it happening here for the Earth, but of course, this is highly exaggerated, so you can see the effect. When you do the calculation, you find that the amount of squeezing and stretching would be tiny, a mere fraction of an atomic diameter. And that makes it pretty difficult to detect. But that is what the LIGO team has now achieved. And they did it with two detectors, one in Louisiana, the other in Washington State. And in these detectors, what they do is they fire laser beams along two 4 kilometer long evacuated tunnels. And when the light recombines, it creates an iconic pattern. It's known as an interference pattern. But the only thing that you need to grasp is that were a gravitational wave to roll by, it would squeeze and stretch the arms of the detector, and that would have a measurable impact on that interference pattern, causing it to shift. And it's just that kind of shift in the interference pattern that the LIGO team has now observed. The first direct detection of gravitational waves.
Okay, so that was Brian Greene explaining that. And but as he said that it's very the video which you saw is very exaggerated, because the stretching and squeezing which happens in this gravitational waves is very small. So to give you a number, it is like 10 to the power minus 21 centimeters. So you have to measure that shift, and thankfully it's a, let's say, technological achievement and all that LIGO actually did it. And so now you have like many catalog of gravitational waves. And just to imagine it once more, I will just see this video. Maybe this will just keep the image. So this is what is happening, but please keep in mind, this is a two-dimensional image. What is actually happening is in three dimensions. So whenever, let's say, this gravitational wave front is coming to Earth, the space and time is stretched in one direction and squeezed in other direction. And this is what LIGO people had discovered. So this is obviously a simulation, but if you're imagining space-time ripples, I mean, if you're imagining gravitational waves in two dimension, this is how it will happen. And just a few words about these three guys who won the Nobel Prize. So it was Rainer Weiss, Barish, and Kip Thorne. Kip Thorne is the guy who was behind the ideas of Interstellar. So just to recap, if you have two very massive objects who are revolving around each other, then this is what happens. And let's say if you and me are shaking the wrist, or I don't know, doing bhangra or something, we will also produce gravitational waves, but those would be very, very small. So you need like very massive objects with very massive gravity in order to have these appreciable effects. And I would end this talk by saying that please stay tuned to our future events on our FB Facebook page, Night Under the Stars. So every week, once a week, we have this Facebook Live talks where we all talk about our research. So you can see this is our group. This is me not successfully trying to write something on the board. This is Unni working. This is Franex Pink Socks. And then these are these are some of us who work for this event. So generally what we do is we call people to our observatory. They either, if they are lucky and the clouds are clean, they see a very good image of the moon, or let's say a nebula, and we have a tour across the observatory. You have very good photos, you can make people jealous on Instagram. So generally, but this is only for the people of Krakow. So in Krakow, we have this English tour, so people can come and see, but due to coronavirus thingy right now, everything is live. And let's say if the pandemic and things end, we will start this again. But till that time, every week there will be new topics. Let's say the formation of stars, or how galaxies are formed, or in future there will be a talk by Shubhrata, like how galaxies are and how do you see galaxies. Then there I think might be a talk by Unnikrishnan on what cosmology is. So right now you were seeing things on the scale of solar system, but when you zoom out and out, there is a different physics. So the cosmology comes into the picture, and Unni might describe this. Karthik may talk about X-ray binary. So this is our event, and I will pause and leave you with this thought by Einstein. I hope I have not made any typo, and I will wait for your question. So there would be a lag, but I will answer your question. So I will just keep the screen like this. So just write your questions on the comment. And thanks. Okay, so Sayyed Zubair asked that, can you explain Interstellar in one FB live session to people like me? Yes, I would. Yes, I can explain this. Maybe I'll tell in what happened during that Interstellar thing. Where were we? Okay, so we were here. So since now you have come up with, you know that you have Einstein's gravity working and all. So in the picture, what happened is that you had this huge supermassive black hole. Please remember, I said supermassive, not black hole. Black hole are few solar masses. Supermassive black holes are few billion solar masses. So that much amount of massive object producing that much amount of gravity. And what happened is that there was this planet nearby. So this, since this planet is nearby, it is under the effect of the gravitational pull of this black hole, and time actually flows differently over there. So this is what happened, that because there were three guys. One guy stayed on the ship, which was away from the orbit. I mean, it was not very close. And then Matthew McConaughey and Anna Hathaway, they went down and they came up. But due to the effect of this gravitational time dilation, time had actually passed. So they spent 1 hour on this planet, but when they came up, and when you do the calculations and all, it's actually 7 years. So this has actually happened, and this can happen. And if you want to measure the gravitational time dilation, you can actually measure it. So if you have two atomic clocks, you keep one clock, let's say on the ground floor, and you keep the other clock at, let's say, 11th floor. And then if you measure the time, let's say after 10, 11 days, you will see that they will not tell the same time. Obviously, this will happen with a very accurate clock. So one is this. So any other questions? Okay, guys. So if you have any other questions, please write on the comment section, and we will write the answer. And if you have any questions any other times, please follow our page. Just get to know about the mysteries of the universe. And we are also PhD students. And okay, wait, I got one question, that how mass distances and times are related to each other. How mass distances and time are related to each other. So this is, I will just try to explain it. This is a question by Vivek Agnihotri and Vikrant. Sorry, this is a question by Vikrant Agnihotri. So I will just go to. Yeah, so the idea was to not to go into the details, but see, so Mr. Vikrant, if you can see this equation on the left, you have some, this is something which is called Riemannian, this is called, actually called Ricci tensor. But what happens is that Ricci, this Ricci tensor or Riemannian curvature, this has the information of your space time together. Because once Einstein came up with special theory of relativity, space and time were on equal footing. So if you are moving with the speed of light, then actually time will fall, time will flow slow for you. This is one of the concept of special relativity. And once Einstein was trying to incorporate gravity in special relativity, he came up with the general theory of relativity. So space and time are on the left side of the equation, this R guys. And if you look at the right hand side, this T mu nu, this is called the stress energy momentum tensor. So it has the mass thing over there. So these are a set of coupled differential equations with space time on the left side and the concept of mass coming on the right side. So this is a rough idea. And in detail, I can maybe message you or write in the comment section. Okay, guys. So any more questions, you can please ask on the comment section and follow our event for, let's say, future amazing talks. And it was a pleasure discussing these ideas with you. And we as PhD students, sometimes we have to explain things simply in order to understand things. It helps us understand better. So if you have any question, please ask it, even if it's the stupidest one. I bet you cannot beat me in asking stupid questions. But thank you and keep smiling.